So I come from a family embedded in fashion, starting with my great-grandfather that would bring textiles all the way from the Arab world to my little country in South America called Ecuador. His legacy continued with my grandfather, and then my father, who started a men's tailoring factory in Ecuador. My earliest memories are of me and my sister going all around picking up the most beautiful scraps of fabric to make each other costumes and for our dolls. That's when I knew I wanted to be a fashion designer. So I worked as hard as I could to make it into Parsons, where I studied fashion design and creative entrepreneurship. And here it was essential because I learned actually how fashion can be that super powerful to create social change. And that was one of the inheritance I got from my family. But the other not so fun inheritance was a life-changing chronic kidney disease. So for that, I had to be some time in the hospital, and during that process and afterwards, I really struggled with dressing, and I felt completely vulnerable when I had to ask my parents even to pull up my pants. Even though for me this was a temporary condition, I was only one of the thousands of people in that hospital. And I wondered, what would it be like for people who can never dress independently or choose their own clothes? So that's when I wanted to focus on creating clothes for people with different diseases and different kinds of abilities. So first, I started exploring clothing for people with diabetes or in kidney dialysis, allowing them to have different openings and closures around their body to make sure they could get access to their daily medication and easier medical checkups. Afterwards, I started working with people with different kinds of mobility, for example, people in wheelchairs or who walk with poles, learning how to adapt clothing to different body postures and enhancing new ways of movement. And finally, it came all the way back to the garment that lit my passion for this, the hospital gown. And so with an amazing team of designers and after more than 65 prototypes, we came to a garment that brought back comfort and dignity to the people who wear it, that can now be bought online and is used in hospitals in New York City. So my passion for this kind of design grew, but I wanted to go one step further and really think, what could inclusive fashion mean? Because working with each of these people really gave us insights and allowing their voice to dictate why and how we designed. So I started working with people who are blind and visually impaired. I was fascinated to discover what would fashion be like for people whose perception of others are not based on appearances, but at the same time wonder what others' visual perception of themselves would be. What would it be like to create a visual identity for those whose visuals are as intangible as feelings? That's why I created VIO. So VIO is a more inclusive system of fashion for the blind and visually impaired, which encompasses a more holistic, sensorial experience of fashion. To learn more about it, I worked with a community of the blind and visually impaired, all the way from babies to teenagers and the elderly, working with educators in this space and assistive technology specialists. And what I learned through all of this was different patterns and habits they had. But the real insights unfolded when I started working with three guys: Gus, Sammy, and Adriel. So first, Gus. He's an assistive technology specialist who is also a counselor of teenagers who are transitioning through their vision loss. He empowers them with the tools that they need to go into the workforce or enter university. He passionately told me that just because he lost his vision did not mean he didn't care about the way he dressed. He loved matching his colorful socks with his shirt, but it was a really long process for him and a hassle. And so what he wanted was for me to create a denim jacket and electric blue pants he had always dreamed of. Then Sammy. Sammy was in his first year of university at NYU. That was a huge accomplishment for him. And that summer, he wanted to get an internship. But he was worried because he'd have to wear professional attire. And he really didn't know how to wear it. And more than looking like stylish or cool, he just wanted to know he could independently pick the appropriate clothing for each situation to make him uniformly fit in. And finally, Adriel. Adriel was in his last years of high school, the most formative years to create your personality and identity. But he told me that he had a big barrier with this because his mom still had to choose his clothes for him every day. And when going shopping, either with family or friends, they would pick out garments for him and describe them. But he really didn't know if he could trust them with what they were picking. And what he wanted was clothing that would show his personality, but at the same time allow him to fit within his group of friends. He told me he wanted all of his garments to match his sneaker, as he's a super sneakerhead. So with all of them, I created three garments for each to allow them to shine their personality, but at the same time, tailored for their special needs. So with their interactions, and through my previous research, I realized that the three fundamental challenges when dressing were with identification, interaction, and safety. So first, identification meant knowing what the garments are and how to create a visual identity. The next, interaction. Interaction was the actual taking off and putting on garments. And finally, safety. Safety meant creating clothing that would keep people safe within their environments, but also work with the current assistive technology they felt comfortable with. So for each of these, I'll share with you a few of the solutions I came up with. So first, for identification, I created a new language that was communicated through touch, sight, and audio. And this was really important because it allowed the wearer to know what the garment was, what it looks like, how to wear it, and how to care for it. That were things that Gus told me he wanted to know on a daily basis. And Adriel really reminded me that something really important was for it not to be another isolated language that is only understood by his community. So we made sure to test it with kids every kind of age and also with adults, and make sure it could be intuitively learned by anyone, finding fun ways to teach it. For example, with this shirt, where on the front there's a tactile visual language, VO, that described the graphics on the back. Second, we wanted to turn all 2D visuals into 3D textures. As Sammy told me, anything that you perceive visually, we also want to perceive tactilely. This was one of my favorite processes, because with Adriel and his friends, we'd get together every Thursday, and I'd bring them different materials and textures for them to tell me what that made them feel, but also we'd play around for guessing what garments these could be used for. For interaction, the first solution was making all garments totally intuitive to wear. Iconic pieces we can all recognize. For example, with Gus, we'd go through how this daily process of dressing could be made faster. And we would time it every time. For example, having different cues around their garments. For example, for him, having Velcro around his opening and closure to make this faster. The next solution was having everything be reversible, because Sammy often felt awkward when he'd wear clothing the other way around. So we thought, why have garments have a right and wrong way? Why not have both sides that can have two different color options, and at the same time wear it however you want to? And lastly, for safety, I made sure that all pockets had closures either with zippers, buttons, or snaps. Because Adriel, when on his commute to school, if he had something misplaced, he couldn't just look around for it. So it would often be practically impossible for him to find again, especially on the streets of New York City. And secondly, something really important was making all the tagging system easy to use with assistive technology that is currently available in any smartphone. For example, VoiceOver and just a simple camera. Because Gus wanted to make sure that his students could access this information in a simple and easy way, to make sure they felt safe on the garments they were wearing. Gus believed that the same way the wheelchair gave access into physical spaces, these tags could give access into the need of daily dressing. So I had the privilege with working with these three guys, who really made me totally rethink what fashion could be like. What I've presented to you today are just the outcomes, but behind the scenes, I had to totally rethink my communication. For example, changing all my sketches into textural, and totally expanding my descriptive vocabulary. But collaborating was essential, because we actually came up with solutions that could make clothing better for everyone. Because believe me, we all underestimate daily dressing until we actually have a challenge with it. And at some time in our life, we all will. That's why I believe in making inclusive design accessible for all. That's what brings me to where I am now, working at Uniqlo, where we create lifewear. Lifewear is clothing to make everyone's life better. Simple, high quality, thought through to make accessible for all. Because dressing more independently and choosing their own garments really changed the way Gus, Adriel, and Sammy felt. It completely boosted their confidence, knowing that they looked amazing and reassured them that they can accomplish anything. And that is a feeling I want to keep spreading. that comes through the power of making fashion more inclusive. So I'd like to leave with you to think about next time you design, how can you make it more inclusive? Thank you.